All right, so let's go ahead and get started. It is now 9:45, and thank you, Marco, for those first couple lectures there. So for those of you tuning in, I am Corey Barat. I'm a practicing colorectal surgeon in a busy community program from Cincinnati, Ohio. I also do some general surgery. I am the director for the Osler colorectal portion, and I also participate with the general surgery. So those of you, I'm sure a lot of you will seem have seen my name or seen me doing a mock oral or something. So active with that. All right, so let's get started. We're going to be talking about some sort of basic anatomy, physiology, benign anorectal. You'll see that some of these things we'll be spending more or less time on. You know, sometimes usually this is the first lecture of the day. We had a little bit of change in our schedule. So just some intro kind of slides here. So the purpose of this course and these lectures is to highlight areas of deficiency for further review, help solidify concepts that you've already learned, and of course, review for the written boards. And this is not, of course, meant to replace reading a textbook. It is not, of course, meant to replace clinical judgment and experience. It is not also meant to be the only right answer in a given situation. I find that, especially with oral boards, many candidates want to know one right way, as if there is only one right way. We all know that in practice and in life, there can be multiple ways to solve a given problem. So be flexible in your thinking, especially when you get towards the oral boards and then in your practice. All right, so a little bit about the test. I consider it essentially an abcite or a general surgery style question. You all have done abcite 5 times at least, and you have all passed your general surgery boards. There's a bit of a deeper level of understanding with regards to specific colorectal topics, pelvic floor, constipation, rectal cancer, miscellaneous tumors, some pediatrics, some interpretations of slides and pictures in radiology. That's a bit more in depth compared to general surgery. And on this test, I found there to be very likely more than one correct answer, and you've got to pick the most correct answer, which I know is going to be tough, but that's the point of the test. There are some fairly recent topics, as in latest NCCN guidelines for rectal cancer as one example. I know I actually had a few questions about a transanal TME on my test as well. I'm not sure if some of those were actually testing the test or experimental questions or not. You won't know. But you've been doing standardized tests your whole life, so this is nothing, there's nothing too special about this one. So common sense test taking skills, of course. So the format of the lectures today, each session is going to be about 45 minutes with multiple, more or less related topics, a few review questions. By the end of today, you should have a large breadth of colorectal surgery covered in the review. And again, depending on timing, we may have time for questions at the end of each session. We are also having a special Q&A session tomorrow, Sunday afternoon at 1 p.m. So if you don't get your questions answered, please put them in the text box, in the chat box, or email them to the course administrators, and we will compile them and review them tomorrow. Also, please give us some honest feedback. You know, we've all been through this experience. As we get further away from the test, we need feedback. We need honest feedback about topics that need to be covered in more or less depth, about how we're doing with the presentations. We want to continue to make this course better and better every year for your colleagues and future colleagues. So let's get into colon histology. So I'm going to adjust my screen in here. And physiology. So some key concepts. The colonic innervation is by the extrinsic and intrinsic systems. The parasympathetic are the excitatory, and the sympathetic are the inhibitory. The intrinsic are the myenteric plexus. Short chain fatty acids, SCFA, are produced by the colon as a result of fermentation of carbohydrates by colonic flora. Butyrate is the most well-known one. It is the primary energy source. Colon absorbs sodium, which is mediated by aldosterone and water, and secretes bicarb and potassium. There are two types of contractions, segmental and propagated. The high amplitude propagating contractions help propel contents distally. The interstitial cells of Cajal are the primary pacemaker cells governing the enteric nervous system. All right, so let's go through. There we go. So this is a normal histology slide. This should look relatively familiar. You can see the four major layers, the mucosa, submucosa, muscularis, divided into the circular and longitudinal layers, and the serosa in intraperitoneal structures. Of course, extraperitoneal structures do not have a serosa. The three main epithelial cell types, the columnar, which is the most common epithelial, the goblet cells, and the enterochromaffin, also known as the EC cells. Again, columnar and goblet make up 95% of the epithelium. The cryptoepithelium are highly proliferative. They secrete chloride ion. The surface epithelium has a low proliferation. It is well differentiated and highly absorptive, as you'd imagine it would be at the surface. The cells of the enteric nervous system are in the submucosa, also known as Meissner's plexus. There's additional layer between the inner and outer longitudinal circular, inner circular and outer longitudinal muscle, also known as Auerbach plexus. And then again, the cells of Cajal come up. And again, you should start, the wheel should start spinning a little bit, gears turning about how this is clinically relevant in various disease states. So the interstitial cells of Cajal are the pacemaker cells. They are c-kit positive stained with a CD117 marker. And they link essentially the submucosa electrochemically with the myenteric plexus. All right, so we're gonna do some questions here. I don't know if you guys will be able to participate in the chat or I'll just probably just go through these. And so other than the physiologic function of the interstitial cells of Cajal as the pacemaker cells of the colon, why are they clinically significant? I'll give you a second to take a look at these. So A, underlying explanation for slow transit constipation. B, they're the precursor cell for squamous cancers of the anus. C, precursor cells for GIST, G-I-S-T, GI stromal tumors, or because Cajal was a Nobel laureate. And E, precursor cell for adenocarcinoma. So again, like any good test, you know, you can eliminate the ones that don't seem to be right at all, the precursors for squamous or adenocarcinoma. We know that these are the Cajal pacemaker cells. Cajal was a Nobel laureate, that is true, but that doesn't make it the right answer to the question, and half true for the slow transit constipation. All right, colonic flora, 10 to the 11 to 10 to the 12 bacteria per gram. That is a just astronomically large number, over 400 species. They contribute to 50% of the fecal mass by weight. Majority are anaerobes, 1,000 to 1. They read on residual proteins and undigested carbohydrates, contribute to both innate and adaptive immunity. And we're learning more and more about the ways that bacterial flora, which is kind of a hot topic in a lot of GI literature, how they contribute to many disease states. Bacteroides is the most common, 2/3 of all bacteria in the colon. But don't forget about some of your gram negatives like E. coli, Klebsiella, Proteus, Lactobacillus, and Enterococci. And again, we mentioned short chain fatty acid fermentation. So, basic physiology and histology. Let's talk about some anorectal anatomy. This is the famous Netter drawing here, or Netter equivalent drawing here. I would say the most important things, well, you guys can see my little cursor there, right? So we know about the anal glands and the crypts and the dentate line. We can see the glands, and this is, again, clinically relevant. We'll get to it in the next lecture about anal abscess and fistula disease. You can see the internal hemorrhoidal plexus, which starts just proximal or above the dentate line. You can see some approximate measurements here. Anal verges, of course, where the hair-bearing skin becomes the non-hair-bearing mucosa of the anal canal, also known as the opening. The anatomic anal canal versus the surgical anal canal, we consider anatomic to the dentate line, and the more surgical, which is probably more commonly referred to in our field, is typically a centimeter or so above the dentate line, while we still have that transition epithelium. So some key concepts, again, we talked about the dentate line is the true division between embryonic endoderm and the ectoderm. The interparenteral reflection is highly variable and can be altered by disease such as prolapse, but it is an important landmark for rectal cancer. Right and left issue rectal space communicate posteriorly through the deep postanal space between the levator ani and anacoxial ligament, important with horseshoe abscesses. Junction of the midgut, which is supplied by the SMA, and the hindgut IMA, is to watershed area of the splenic flexure. and again, the GI rotation during development. So again, we talked about the anatomic versus surgical anal canal. Again, there's some disparity discrepancy between men and women, and even among the same gender. The internal anal sphincter is continuous with the circular muscle of the rectum. So again, this is important if you're going to be doing an intersphincteric proctectomy and you want to connect your planes from the abdomen to the perineum. The external sphincter extends past the internal anal sphincter and has three parts. They are, we name them, but in reality, they are hard to actually distinguish between the layers, subcutaneous, superficial, and deep. The intersphincteric groove is a very important landmark. So why? I mean, we use this landmark all the time when we're doing lateral internal sphincterotomies, when we're doing lift procedures, when we're determining the intersphincteric versus transphincteric anal fistula. So I think this is probably one of the most important landmarks up there with the dentate line. All right, so some pelvic floor basic anatomy. You can see sort of the pelvic bowl muscles and the levator ani, which typically make a U-shape posterior to the rectum and help change the angles with defecation. We'll talk about that a little bit more. You can see the superficial transverse perineal muscle between the in the rectovaginal space, typically can be thinned out after childbirth. All right, so again, levator ani, made up of three muscles, pubococcygeus, puborectalis, iliococcygeus, innervated by the pudendal nerve branches, the perineal nerve and inferorectal nerve, as well as direct S3 and S4 nerve branches. The puborectalis, this is the most important for continence. The fibers arise from, as you'd expect, the lower part of the pubis and superior fascia of the urogenital diaphragm, run alongside the anorectal junction, form a sling or a U-shape, and contraction of this muscle causes horizontal forces that close the pelvic diaphragm and decrease the anorecta angle during a squeeze. All right, so here's histology of the anal canal. Again, this is important when we're thinking about malignancy. The columnar epithelium act very differently than the squamous epithelium. And then there's this anal transition zone. You can see on this slide where it's a little bit of both. The actual length of the rectum. So, you know, these measurements can vary. There is no exact guidelines. I would say most people consider 0 to 5, 5 to 10, 10 to 15, but some textbooks look at 0 to 7, 7 to 12, 12 to 15, or even 16. Again, this becomes important when you're doing measurements for rectal cancer, rectal lesions, determining the best way to remove a rectal lesion, either transanal or tamus. The majority of the rectum, as we know, is extraperitoneal, as the anterior and lateral upper rectum is covered by visceral peritoneum up to the anterior peritoneal reflection. Again, that's exactly what that means, is that it's a reflection of the peritoneum separating intraperitoneal from extraperitoneal on the anterior surface. And that is, again, variable and can change with anatomy, with physiology, with prolapse, but typically measured somewhere from 9 to 10, sometimes can be up to 12. Again, another view of the peritoneal surfaces and folds on a nice netter drawing here. So let's talk about some of these fascias and folds. The presacral fascia is the thickened endopelvic fascia overlying the sacrum, covers the presacral veins, importantly, and the hypogastric nerves, contributes laterally to the lateral ligaments of the rectum, and covers the anococcygeal ligament. The rectosacral fascia, also known as Waldeyer's fascia, originates in the third and fourth portion of the sacrum and extends anteriorly to the posterior of the fascia propria, 3 to 4 centimeters proximal to the anorectal junction. So this is a fascia you will see when you're doing the posterior dissection in the TME plane, and you have to sharply divide this. If you try to use blunt dissection, this is what you could actually rip some of the presacral fascia, cause bleeding, and get out of the correct plane. Danvilliers fascia, Danvilliers, whoever's French can correct me. This is a fascia that arises from the fusion of the embryologic peritoneal cul-de-sac, extends from the deepest point of the retrovesical pouch to the pelvic floor. This has nerves in the anterolateral border, also known as the periprostatic plexus, which can clinically, importantly, help with bladder function and erectile function in men. You can see a drawing here of the sympathetic nerves. importantly, the superior hypogastric nerves as they cross over the sacral promontory, which is clinically relevant for high ligation of the IMA, as we all should be doing. Some of the parasympathetic nerves, like most parasympathetic nerves, follow the arterial supply. So the innervation of the anorectum. So sympathetic arise from L1, L2, L3, and pass through the sympathetic chains to join the pre-aortic plexus. They then run adjacent to the IMA. The hypogastric nerves contain both sympathetic and parasympathetic fibers from S2, 3, 4. Periprosthetic plexus is a division of the pelvic plexus. The external anal sphincter is supplied on each side by inferior rectal branches of the internal pudendal nerve from S2 and